This video file was recorded in Sabunji University during recitations for the CS204 Advanced Programming course as it was given in the spring semester of 2017.
Good afternoon again. We are back for the second week. We're going to learn new stuff today. Namely, we're going to deal with preprocessing stuff, compilers, linkers, static libraries, not dynamic libraries, and pointers. Now, I saw that you don't have any questions from the previous week. That's why let's not waste our time, and let's go with the topics of today. Before going to the examples, also please, if you've not downloaded the codes, please download them from the professor's website. Now, let's go and remind you something that you have done in lectures. I would suggest to you before coming here, just go through the lectures like 5 or 10 minutes to remind yourself what you did during the lectures. I'm going to do a very brief review of some topics that you did in the lectures, namely preprocessor, compiler, and linker. What is this stuff? Very briefly, the most important stuff. So, we have used this stuff. We have included libraries that are already written from someone else, like the string, the IO stream, and so on. And we have included headers, libraries, that we have written during the scope of the CS201, Introduction to Computing. And we wrote them like this. The difference is that if we write them in quotation mark, first we are going to check the current working folder, and then we will check a special folder. If you write those like this in brackets, angle brackets, we're going to check only that special folder. And string, iostream, and others are included in that special folder. Otherwise, we can include string in quotation marks. It's not a problem. What else we have done? I think that we have seen this one. If we use the constant pi in our program, we can define it like this, pi, and the value 3.14. Or if we are going to use, built-in array, and it has constant size of 10,000 elements, then we can define max size 10,000. Or we can define a string, please enter your move, like this, okay? So we have seen include, we have seen define. Of course, those are constants, we can do the constant in this way, but I might show you why this one might be a little bit more preferred. So this might be a global constant. We are going to write, let's say, a huge math application, and we want to have a global constant called pi, which will be seen for all. All can access, all the program and program parts can access this constant. This guy do the same thing, but they are not the same. So we have seen include, we have seen define. And also I want to take your attention and remark, emphasize that we use here the pound sign, the sharp sign, okay? And we will see why. But here we don't use it. Also, we can do something like this. So, pi, max size, prompt, alcohol are called identifiers. You can see them as a kind of variables. Yes? Yeah. It's a constant, you cannot change it. So pi is this much, max size is this much, prompt is this, you cannot change it. It's kind of a constant, that's why we have written it. You can write it like this, const double pi, okay? They're doing the same thing. If you use in your program pi, or this pi, the program cannot distinguish where's the difference. But the compiler can do it. I'll tell you where's the difference. Also, so again, those guys, pi, max size, prompt, are called identifiers. You can see them as variables. We have also those kind of sentences, like if identifier was not identified, then do something else, and if. Okay? Let's say, I'm going to this example here. I'm defining here my debug, and it has no values. I'm just defining it. It exists. And I'm saying, if I've defined my debug, then see out this guy. and if. So this goes with this guy here, okay? This is the syntax, how we define those conditional clauses, conditional preprocessing. So now, what is preprocessing? This is a program, especially include and define, we have seen till now. We are going to write a program in this way. Instead of copy-pasting all of the parts of the dice point H, we can write define dice point H, and we include the dice library. Is this better? It is better for us, but unfortunately, the compiler directly cannot understand this include dice point H, okay? The dice library might have, or any library that we have written might have hundreds, thousands of codes, and you don't want to copy-paste them, especially if we include like tens or maybe dozens of libraries. Okay, you don't want to copy-paste the code, but unfortunately, the compiler does understand only this stuff. So basically, the compiler wants to copy-paste the code and run it. But we don't want to do that. Usually, programmers are lazy, and they want to do it in the simplest way possible. That's why we include dice, then we define my debug, and I'll tell you, maybe this lecture the next one, why how we can use this define clause and those if statements here. So what's happening in the background? When you press the compile button, preprocessing happens, a kind of pre-compiling before the real compilation, okay? This is called preprocessing. Preprocessing takes this stuff as an input, and what it's doing is the following. It says, okay, the user wants me to include the dice library, and it checks in the current folder whether there is a library called dice.h. If it exists, it basically copy-pastes the code of dice, copies it, and pastes it here, okay? Then we go on, define my debug. I've defined a variable called my debug. And I'm asking, have I defined my debug? If I've done that, and this is true because I've defined it, then this cout is put here, okay? This is what the preprocessing is doing. Do something is a function that we have written. It goes here, and this is the end. So the input of preprocessing is this guy, the output is this guy. This is called a translation unit. Now, this is stuff that the compiler can compile, can understand, and can execute, okay? Compile and execute, okay? So wherever you have these signs, that means that the preprocessing is going on, a kind of compilation before compilation. Now, we want to be more lazy. We're including libraries in some programming languages. It's by default, you should include 10 or 15 libraries, maybe dozens, 30, 40 libraries, and it's very hard to do. So you might say, okay, can we simplify this inclusion of libraries? Yes, we can. Let's say in the scope of CS201, libraries like string, IOStream are there, but libraries like dice, random generator, the date, you remember them? What else? Prompt. Libraries that we use during the CS201 are not part of the default libraries that come with the compiler. That's why what we want to do is the following. We want in a way to zip them and have them and use them whenever we want without having to copy paste the code. This is called static libraries. So we merge the libraries and we use them as we will. Let's go with the first example. And let's create libraries, static libraries, but just follow me because this is going to be a bit different. So, now you have a clue what's preprocessing, how it's going on, and now let's go and do something with static libraries. Start a new project, file new, project. Go to Visual C++. Go to Windows 32 console application. Let's change the name of this guy to what? Let's say static library example. Click OK. Are you following? Now click Next. Now the default till now has been the console application, but I don't want to create a console application. I want to create a static library. That's why I checked the static library. And everything else should be unchecked. We can do it even if it's checked, but let's not complicate our lives. And let's put it like this, unchecked. Click Finish. Now we have a new project, and it has one a new solution. It has one project inside, and in this project we want to create static libraries, libraries that we use and put them in one place, so we can take this file and copy paste it without explicitly have to include them one by one. Yes. Can I do it again? Okay. Let me do it again. Very briefly. Fly new. Project. You go to Windows 32 console here, Visual C++, Windows 32. You change the name. Okay, you can put it as you wish. I put it here, static lib example. Click OK. Then click Next. Instead of console application, you check static library. And everything else is unchecked. Okay. So this window should look like this. And you press Finish. This is it. I'm not going to press Finish here. Oh, I don't have my solution folder, then I have to open it. Let me create it because I forgot the name. File new project, Windows 32, CS204, static library example. Okay, next, static library, everything unchecked, finish. Now, if you have downloaded your code, you should go to the tabs folder of the downloaded zip file, open it, and select all of the files here, all of the headers and the corresponding CPP files. We have seen this stuff in CS201, all of those libraries. Copy them, go to the solution folder here, and you can go to the solution folder by right-clicking here, open folder in File Explorer, and paste everything here. Okay. Now go to the source files and add all of existing items here, like random generator, prompt CPP, dice CPP, date CPP. In total, we have four libraries. Add them all. It's a polite way. How am I doing this stuff? I'm just pressing the control button, CTRL, and left clicking, and drag and drop those to the header portion here, to the header tab. They can stay there to the source file, but usually headers go to the header file. Now just let me briefly, like a couple of minutes or so, remind you what these guys do. For sure you remember them from the CS201. The prompt library has no classes inside. It has some functions. And in those functions, you have a string, and you have other parameters. You prompt, like give your name, and you expect a name. Or you say, give the range, and you give the lower bound of the interval and the higher bound, okay, the range, let's say between 5 and 10. So this is the prompt library. The random generator generates random numbers. The most important part of this class are those four functions. Random integer, it's overloaded. Overloaded means we have the same name, but different number or types of parameters. We have in random integer here one parameter, which is max, and this generates a random number between 0 and max. We have random integer with low and max. We generate an integer between low and max in this interval. We generate a real number here and a real number here. This is it. We have the class dice, if you remember. The constructor of the dice takes the number of sides. If we give it as 2, it's going to be a coin. If we give it a 6, it's going to be a normal dice that we have seen till now. Well, another function here is roll. We are going to use it today. Roll means if I have a dice, let's say, with 6 sides, I just throw it and take the outcome of the experiment, which is a random number between 1 and 6. Number of sides, it returns the number of sides of the dice. Number of rolls, I can throw it as many times as I want, and I increment it each time. And we have the date class also, if we remember it. Some of the functions here are, let's say, month. Here we return the month. For instance, today is 16th of February, 2017. So it's going to return 2, second of month. Day returns the day. Day name returns Thursday for today. Month name returns February, and so on. Now, if we are sure that in our life we are going to deal with those libraries, what we want to do is to gather them in one place and use them as we need those libraries. That's why we are going to create something that is called a static library. Just let me show you. Okay, so here is our solution folder. We have it here. I go up one level, and we see we don't have any folder here. Also, we don't have here any main function. That's why when I'm going to compile it, you might say that we are going to see something like, okay, a warning, which is not an error. We don't have the main. Because in order to execute something, you need to have the main function. This is the function from where the compiler starts executing. It's the main, the first function, then where the compiler starts basically its execution. So I'm going to compile this stuff, and you remember again, we don't see anything else here. This is the solution folder. This is one level up. We don't see anything. So I'm compiling it. I'm doing the random generator, the prompt, the dice, the date. And 1 succeeded, 0 failed, 0 blah, blah, blah. But everything is succeeded. I have this error because unable to start. Of course, I cannot start. I don't have the main function. I cannot execute it. I press OK. Now let's go to this solution folder. You see this debug stuff? We didn't have it, but we have it now. Let's see what we have inside. We have the output, and the output is a file which is called CS204 static lib example, point lib. This is a library file. We have included all of those libraries that we saw here, and we can use this file when we write our programs without explicitly having the need to include dice.cpp, prompt.cpp, date.cpp, or random generator.cpp, because we have them here. Okay, so we can copy paste them, this file, we can put it in our stick, in our flash, in our USB, and take it with us. Let's see this stuff. But remember, we have this in the debug folder. Why? Because we compiled this stuff in the debug mode. And what's the difference between debug and another mode is release? We will see it later on. Okay? We debugged it, we compiled it in the debug mode. That's why we have the debug folder and the library here. Okay, we're going to do something that we haven't done in CS201. In CS201, in the Introduction to Computing course, we had only one project. For one solution, we had only one project. But we are going to add another one. So how we are going to do that? Go here to the solution. So this is a solution, this is a project. Go to the solution, right click, and we have this option, add new project. Click this guy, add new project. It's going to be a console Well, let's rename it to CS204. What? Show example. Or lib usage example. So we're going to use the library. Note next, it's going to be a console. We don't need anything, it should be empty actually. We don't need anything precompiled, finish. And we have this library. So we have the static library example, we created the library here. Now we want to use the library here. In order to use it, let's go to the second folder for today. This is the arrays library. Just select all of the files from here. Copy them. Now go to this library, CS204 library usage example. Open the solution folder, the folder for it, and paste everything here. You see, here we have the headers, but not the CPPs. We're not going to need them because the library, the static library, has them for us. Now, let's add the newly created items. Are you following me? Are there any questions in there? Yeah, you have a question? Okay. Let's add the newly pasted items, namely, they're going to be the random generator, prompt, main, dice, and date. Add them. Now, since we have for the solution two different projects, we should explicitly tell to the compiler which is the startup one, okay? When we start compiling, when I press the compile button over there, am I going to compile this one and execute this one first? Because this one might have a CPP, a main, with a CPP file that has the main function, which is not the case here, that's why it's not executable. But here we have the main CPP, but since this project was added later, it's not going to be executed first. That's why we should do something like this. Go to the project, right-click it, and there is something, set a startup project, okay? So click this guy. And this will be the startup project. We will start executing this guy. Now we have main here. This is the main function. Now, what do you think? If I press the compile button, am I going to execute it properly or not? Yes or no? By the way, in this main function, I'm using the libraries dice and date. Let's try it. But what do you think? Is it going to be executed or not? What's your opinion? Come on, try it. You won't be punished if you give wrong mistakes. I haven't beaten any students in my life. Trust me. It will not work. Why? You're right. What's the reason? Exactly. We have the headers, but we don't have the CPPs. And you should know what the header is. I'm not going to go to that again. So I've set up this as a startup project. And I tried to execute, and oh, we have this guy here. Let's see what's the error. It has, okay, I'm trying to call this guy dice, but unresolved external symbol. I don't know how to do it, because I just declared the function in the dice header file, but I don't define it. I also tried to call dice roll, but I don't have it. I don't know how to use it. In order to fix this issue, we can either add the CPPs as we have done till now, or even better, we can do something like this. So let me just copy, just drag and drop the header files to the header file section. Source files are here. You might have asked, okay, we have the header and the source, but what's the resource about? Well, in the resource file, we can add libraries that we need. In our case, the static library that we created. So add, right-click at it, add existing item, go one level one level up. You remember this folder here, debug? We had the library there. So click this guy, select it, click add, and we have the library here. That means that this project is going to use this resource file as a kind of external resource for our needs, okay? This is the static library. Now if I compile and run the code, I don't have any mistake. It's working. Because I have CPPs there. You might say, okay, why we're adding the headers, why not CPPs? You might be in a way correct. That's why we have dynamic libraries, but we're not going to be engaged in them today. But this makes our life easier. Especially it made easier for me, because sometimes I have the headers, but I've lost the CPPs, and I have only this library, so I can use it. I don't have to have the CPPs. I don't need to have the CPPs. We have this output here. What are we doing in this file is basically the following. We create a dice with six sides, a normal dice. In Turkish, I think you call it zar, okay? And we roll it 100 times, okay? So that means we repeat the experiment 100 times. Now, the dice has numbers from 0, from 1 to 6. We create a vector like this, 1, 2, 3, till 6. How many elements do I have here? 7. But I'll skip the 0 and I'll start from 1. So I roll the dice 100 times and I see the outcome. If I initially everything is 0 here, this guy also, but I don't care about this one. And I keep the count, and I keep the count of the occurrences of the experiment here. Okay, so I roll the dice once and I get, let's say, 2. So I increment this 2 by 1 and it becomes 1. I roll it again and I get 3. I increment this guy by 1. I roll it again and I have, let's say, 2 again. So I increment it 2 and so on. I do this stuff 100 times. And in the end, I will have something like, let's say, we have 21 here, 22 here, 19 here, and let's say 17 here. All of those sum up to 100. This is what the program is doing. But I skip the 0 and I start from 1 to 6, okay? Now let's see, and let's go through the code one by one. Let me first enlarge the font. Okay, so this is our outcome, okay? All of those guys sum to 100. Now, main.cpp, let me enlarge the font. Okay, in the beginning, I define an identifier called array. It's a kind of variable. I also define a constant, which is not pre-processed, since it doesn't have that the sharp sign, the pound sign. It's a constant, this is the dice size, it's going to be 6, okay? We are sure for that. In the main, we define those variables, k and value. We need k for iterating from 0 to blah, blah, blah. Number of trials is 100. We create a dice with 6 sides, a normal, a usual dice. Now we are asking, have we defined the array? If we have defined the array, this guy is going to be true, okay? So have we defined array before? Yes, we have defined. That's why this guy here is highlighted. If I don't define it, let's say, let me just comment this guy, see what's going to happen. So you see, this guy is highlighted, but this guy is like in shadows, okay? It's not highlighted, this part here. If I comment this block, see what's going to happen now. It's vice versa, okay? This is not highlighted. This means that this is not going to be part of a translation unit, of the output of the preprocessing, okay? Because I've not defined array, I have commented it, and I'm asking, did I define array? No. Then we go to the else part, and we deal with this stuff. Basically, this is what I'm doing. If I define the array, the identifier array, which is going to be preprocessed, I'm going to use, what is this? A built-in array. You know the difference between the built-in arrays and the vectors? Dynamic vectors? Well, again, built-in arrays are static. You cannot add new elements. When you run the program first, you should explicitly tell that, okay, I'm going to use a vector of size 7, dice plus 1, 7, because this is a vector of size 7. And this is it. I cannot use pushback. I cannot increment it, okay? It's going to be static, not dynamic. And this is called array. I say that all the elements are integers, okay? With the vectors, this is dynamic vector. I can use pushback. I can add new elements at the end of the vector. And this was not the case with the static vectors. So if I define array, I want to use built-in arrays. Otherwise, if I don't define it, I'm going to use dynamic arrays. For this case, it's better to use static arrays or built-in arrays because the size of this vector, is it going to change? No. We have 7 elements. We need only indexes from 1 to 6 for keeping the count, recording the count, and it's going to be constant. But if we know that the size might change, then we should use dynamic arrays. So these guys can be changed. You can use the property point pushback, the method, the member function. Here we don't have pushback because you cannot change the size of this array here. This is built-in array, this is dynamic array. This is static, this is dynamic. If I've defined the array identifier, then I'm going to use static array. Otherwise, if it's not defined, I'm going to use the vector. The way how I access the element is the same. So if the name of the array here is counter, of the vector is counter. Of the static vector is counter, of the dynamic one is again counter. The way how I access elements is the same for both of them. It's like counter I, and this is it, okay? So just let me also write a piece of code here. I'm going to write this one, cout. You are using built-in, I can say static array, new line. You don't need it, but just to see the output, to show what's going on. Here, if this guy is going to be executed, you see it's not emphasized, you are going to use dynamic array. You can call it also vector. Okay, so far so good. Whether we are using a dynamic or static one, I don't care. The rest of the code is the same. I go from 0 to die size, and I set all the elements initially to be 0. Okay. Then in this for loop, I conduct the elements from 0 to number of trials, 100 times. I start from 0 to 99, which is 100. I get a value after rolling the dice, and according to this value, incrementing the index. If I get 2, I increment index 2. If the value is 1, increment index 1. If it's 6, I increment 6. I repeat this guy 100 times, and in the end, I print the output. Okay, the occurrence of dice value 1 is blah, blah, blah. 2 is blah, blah, blah. From 1 to dice size is 6. And I print the elements. I don't print 0. I print elements from 1 to 6. Okay? Is this clear? Just let me run the code again. Now, since I've defined the array, this guy is going to be executed. Okay? This is not emphasized. That's why we should get you are using built-in array or static array. So I'm running the code. You see, you are using built-in static array, and this is the outcome. Now, let me change it. Let me change it. I can either delete or comment this guy. When I comment this guy, now you see, this guy is going to be emphasized, this guy not. Because the array is not defined, I run it. You are using dynamic array or vector. Basically, the translation unit when the pre-processing happens. This is going to be deleted, of course. This is deleted. This is deleted. This stays, okay? So, how the pre-processing works. Instead of IO stream, you include the code of IO stream. It's like copy-pasting it. Instead of vector, you include the code of vector. You include the code of dice of date. And you include the namespace, the standard namespace. Then you go here. You define array. Let's say you are defining it. And you remember that you have defined it. If you have defined it, then this part is going to be erased. This part is also going to be erased. Everything else remains. And this is a translation unit. This is a preprocessing. Afterwards, I'm compiling it and actually executing. Any questions about this stuff? Now you might ask, okay, why, what the hell we need this define array? Or what's the problem with this debug or release stuff? We are going to see it right now. Yes? Yeah, if this is a problem for you, I'm going to make it return zero. Do you have a problem now? Okay. You can return 1,000, 1 million, whatever. You should return an integer. Questions? No questions. Okay. If this is clear, now let's go with another example before the break, which is called the assert sample. I don't want to waste my time creating new project. That's why I'm just going to remove this stuff here. And this stuff. Okay, this guy can stay. I don't care about them. Then go to assert example. Copy paste this stuff, everything. Copy it. And paste it to the solution folder about this one, okay? If you're not sure which one is which, go to the solution folder the one that we had the main example, main.cpp, okay? If you're not sure which one is that, just go. Open folder in the file explorer and paste everything here. Assert example. Yeah, everything inside that folder. Now, again, let's add what we need here. We are going to add the random generator. Random generator, buggy dice. Okay, random generator and CPP, buggy dice, H and CPP and main CPP. The buggy dice header was not part of the static library. That's why we are going to add it with the CPP here. We can use the static library of the previous example, but let's not do it. Let's add the H and the CPP here because we are done with the static library. We see how they work. Random generator, I didn't add the CPP, I'm going to add it now. Which one? Random generator, header, okay. I cannot add it, okay. I cannot add it since I have it in the library. Let it be so. This is the main. Now let's see what buggy dice is doing. It's exactly the same as the dice.h library. With one example, this roll function, instead of returning numbers between 1 and 6, it returns between 0 and 6. Meaning if I throw a dice with 6 sides, I should get something between 1 and 6. But if I get a 0, it makes no sense. So this is a buggy dice with a bug. So here it should be between 1 and my sides. This is in the original dice header, but we have added 0 on my sides in order to make a mistake. Now what's assertion? Very often we deal with problems when we are running or compiling or writing our codes, especially when we are compiling and executing our codes. Problems that occur, mistakes that occur, are mistakes like dividing by zero. Okay, you ask from the user to give two integers as an input, and the second one is integer, and you divide the first one with the second one. So this is a mistake. You cannot divide by zero. Or let's say we have a vector of seven elements, and you try to access the eighth or the ninth or the tenth element. You try to access something that does not exist. This is a mistake. Okay. In order to avoid those mistakes, we can, and in order for the program to finish, terminate, but in a polite manner, not something like, okay, a message is displayed and break, and you're, what the hell is this, okay? Confused. Something with a proper message like, okay, this stuff occurred, and don't be afraid, nothing bad happens. It's not your fault. And we try to prevent this stuff. In order to prevent this stuff, we are going to use assertions. Assertions is like making sure that that will not occur. If it occurs, the problem occurs, let's say dividing by zero, it will tell you something like, okay, the program terminated because you divided by zero. Don't be afraid. So let's see what we have here. We saw the buggy dice, the random generator is the same. This is the main CPP file. Not 400. Let's run this code and see what do we get. No, not this one. I'm going to clean the solution and run it again. Okay, what's the problem? I cannot find this guy. Why I cannot find it? I'm going to remove this guy then. Okay, hope it should work now. Okay, this is the mistake that I got. I have a dice and I'm rolling it 10 times. When I roll it the first time, I have a message, the outcome is 1. The second time, the outcome is 5. You see the output there? Then 2, then 6, again 6. When I roll it and I get 0, this makes no sense because the dice has numbers between 1 and 6. An error occurs. And I have a message like this. Okay, abort has been called. I've accorded it on purpose. And I have here the message why this problem occurred. Well, assertion failed because value was not equal to 0. This value here should not be equal to 0. If it's equal to 0, then I abort. And I give a message telling which line aborted it, okay? So I press abort and this is it. This is done using assertions. And how do I do that? Well, in order to use assertions, I should include this folder, which is part of libraries that come with the Visual Studio or any compiler, C++ compiler. I include that. And at the place where I'm expecting a mistake, I'm using this clause here, assert. Okay? So I repeat this experiment of throwing the dice 10 times, and I get the value, I print the value, and I assert that this value here is not equal to 0. Meaning that if this is true, it's okay, I don't have any problems. But if this is false, then I should stop the program and not run it again. Assert means make sure. Make sure that value is not equal to 0 because it makes no sense. You should get something between 1 and 6. Okay? So this is how we did it. Again, you should include the CAssert header here and use the assert statement in this manner here. What the program is doing is very simple. Again, we have k value, number of trials, we have a dice. We create a dice, and so the number of trials is 10. We repeat this experiment 10 times, and we print the outcome each time. When we get a 0, we stop doing this stuff, okay? Here I was very lucky, you see? I did 10 times, I didn't get any 0. Okay, but not always I'm lucky. Now, we are about to finish in 5 or 10 minutes. I don't want to give you a break now because of the continuity, okay? Now let's explain other parts of the code. We are using the debug technique here, the debug mode. But if I'm using the release mode, see what happens. Again, we didn't get any zero. Let me run it again. No zero. Why I don't have any zeros? Let me rebuild the solution. Okay. I'm running it. I have zero, but I don't have any mistake. Why? The problem is that I did it in the release mode, okay? If I did it in the debug mode, I would have this stuff, okay? But in the release mode, I don't have mistakes. Even if I get zero here. Now, what's the difference between debug and release? When you write your code, you will have a lot of bugs, a lot of mistakes. You remember debugging from CS201, also breakpoints, step into, step over. You remember this stuff from CS201? My preferred way, so when you were looking for the code, you put some breakpoints. Let's say you put a breakpoint here and here, and you run the code. And here in the locals, okay, not here. Where was it? At the output or the variables? Never mind. You were seeing the current value of your variables. My preferred way of doing this stuff is to use cout. For instance, I might use a code. I'm not going to need those guys. I'm using a code. In this code, I have an integer a and b. I have a character C and a string, let's say name. And I want to see the output in like every 10 or 15 lines of code. That's why I do something like this. C out, I'm printing A. This is for debugging stuff, to see whether everything is okay up until that point of the code. Name, I should print also C. Okay, so this is the way I do the debugging stuff. No breakpoints. I might copy. Okay, let this guy be a double, because I should include the string. Okay. Now, I can use some codes here. Also, I have codes here. And I want very often to trace, to track those four variables. That's why I print them here. Let's say I print them here also to see what's going on using the cout. I print them here also in order to use them and see what's going on. But this is when you write your homework assignments. This is a good way of doing things to see whether it's okay or not. But however, when you're going to upload your assignments, you should delete this stuff. But what if you use like 20, 30 times cout? Okay? That's why, in order not to do, and you should delete those couts. In order not to do this, you can do something like this. You can write in the beginning, and you can define an integer called debug, and you say debug is 1, meaning that I'm debugging mode. And here you can use if I'm debugging, if it's not over, is equal to 1, then print. I want to see the output of these guys, okay? And when debug, and when you see that you don't have any mistakes, you just put debug to be 0 and you don't print it anymore. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? And this is ready for the release. Release meaning you can upload it for the assignments, or if you're a web developer, you can release it for the public, an application that everyone can download and use. You can do it your way, but since programmers are lazy, what happens is the following. You have two ways of doing of coding and debug and compiling. Debug and release. Debug is exactly when you want to do debugging, and we are sure, and when you are sure you don't have mistakes, you use the release mode, meaning that okay, it's okay for release and everybody can use it, no bugs. In the debug mode, you have this clause defined. If defined, you see, debug. Okay, you don't remember that debug that I set to 0 or 1? Okay, when you use the debug mode, automatically this is set. This is a kind of variable.
But it doesn't show.
It doesn't show in the translation unit, but you can see it here. Okay, and you see if I'm using the debug mode, and this is the debug mode, then see out this guy. But if I'm using the release mode, you see it's not. Because this guy here, this variable identifier here, is only for the debug mode. And you can do it when you are debugging your code. You can use, okay, if define debug, see out, blah, 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 blah. When you see you don't have mistakes, the output is as you want. Just go to the release mode, and the translation unit will not take this into consideration. Okay, we'll skip it. Now, so this is what... If this is everything about this stuff, about the debug mode and release mode, let me run the code. Okay, the problem is with those variables that I defined and declared. Let me run the code and let's see the output. Okay, we have a mistake here because we are using This is a very good mistake. If we didn't use CSERT, we are trying to print something that we didn't initialize. And you have a mistake like this. And you don't want to get a mistake like this because you get afraid and frightened. But you want to get mistakes like this, for instance. Okay, this is better. And it tells you where is the mistake, okay? That I did it. The mistake is that I have a zero, blah, 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 okay? This is much better way of doing things. Again, assert does not work with the release mode. Assert works with the debug mode only, okay? Now, I'm going to give you a break of 5 minutes, and I'm just going to tell you that while the assert technique is a good one, there is another technique which is even better than this one, which are called exceptions. This is called exceptions. We will deal with exceptions in like 2 months from now. So remember this word, exceptions, and we'll see what they're about. We'll be back in 5 minutes.